Well, hello there. Welcome everybody to Old Ass Movie Reviews. I'm Dave.
That's Scott.
And we are going to review today A Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yes.
They say that it's Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas. It's not. He barely showed up for this damn thing. He'd come in and complain about designs. He'd come in and watch a daily or something that they did, like a 10-second thing, complain about it or say something and then leave. The guy who deserves all of the credit for this, let me see if I can find his name. Cast and crew. I don't want the cast. I want the crew. I want the actual.
The actual director, which is director. Not Tim Burton.
It is not Tim Burton.
No, it's not.
The two guys are Ralph Eggleston and Dean Taylor. Those are the two guys that you can thank for this. And I think Eggleston is the main guy, if I remember correctly, on a couple of the specials that I've watched about this. I always thought that Burton was like hands-on on this thing all over the place.
I did too.
And then I watched a couple of specials and some interviews with some people, and they were like, yeah, he's barely there. Like, how his name is even on it, I couldn't tell you.
And it's not really. It's not, because that's when I started watching it yesterday. Mm-hmm. I don't know, for some reason my brain was telling me I was expecting to see Tim Burton on the title card there.
And right.
It's not there. And then I saw another director and I was like, oh, that's right. Tim Burton did not even direct this. So.
Yeah. But it's very misleading when you see that on the cover. Tim Burton's Nightmare Before Christmas. I think it was because of a basic idea he had.
Mm-hmm.
And he did go in and help, like when they were doing the drawings and the designs.
Yeah.
They took his basic stuff and then built on that. But really, I mean, when it boils down to it, by the time it's all said and done, I mean, it has that Tim Burton feel.
Oh, it absolutely does.
But it's thanks to these other two guys. I mean, and the casting director, the voice casting director, the actors, the actresses. Mm-hmm. It's amazing. Before I start gushing, you go ahead. You gush first.
Well, that's assuming I'm going to gush. There are
you're going to gush.
About the animation and the artistic style. Absolutely. Yeah. This movie is gorgeous. I love this style. And I think that's one of the things that when I say style, I'm talking about the style of animation.
Right.
The artistic sense is Tim Burton-esque, I guess you could say.
Right, right.
Which I like as well. But the this animation style, is it stop motion or is it CGI?
Yes.
It is stop motion. It's beautiful. It's smooth. It's
unbelievable.
It looks incredible. And that's why I was like, is it blended with CGI and done? It's wonderful. Yeah. It's absolutely gorgeous.
This is one of those movies that when Kat and I went to see it, we I don't even think we were married yet. I don't think we were. It's an old movie, so we've been married for a while. We're an old couple. But we went to see this at the movies when it originally came out, and I remember her and I sitting in the theater just whispering to each other how beautiful this thing was. I was in animation school at the time.
Oh, shit.
And doing a little bit of stop motion, so I know. Not to their level, not anywhere near their level, for Christ's sakes. But I know how difficult it is just to get, you know, 30 seconds worth of time.
It takes
onto
a long
a piece
time.
Of film. And these guys, oh my God in heaven, such beautiful work and all the different faces that they had to move, mm-hmm. everything they had to take. And I think they said that each character, each of the main characters had like 40 or 50 or more faces.
Yeah.
So every little surprise or grin was like everything in between.
So they
were taking these
the frames,
separately.
Basically.
Oh yeah. Oh my God. Wow. It was crazy. Beautiful. Oh my God. Those guys are artists.
And that's one of the things that really caught my attention. I love good stop motion. Thanks to Ray mm-hmm. Harryhausen.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
The skeletons in Sinbad will always be like,
yeah, Matt, and that thing that just went by you. That's
yeah, that was stop motion cats.
Stop motion cat tail.
Yes. Anyway, yeah, but that whole style is amazing to me, and that because you know the dedication and the work, but it's so smooth.
Yeah,
it's so fluid, and it just it's got, I love how this movie makes me feel. It's just, it's a cool movie. It's not, I'm not as a huge a fan as some people, but I enjoy this movie. I'm sorry. It's, yeah.
You will be beaten later.
It's, I mean, it's good. It's just some of the, I don't know. Look, I love Oogie Boogie, and I would, you got to have Oogie Boogie everywhere. That was my favorite character out of the whole thing. But I like, I like what this, I like Oogie Boogie. And here's the weird thing. It's only because Oogie Boogie is a Disney villain.
Oh, yeah. And he winds up like a Disney villain.
Yeah. Exactly. And it's all like Disney villains should end that way. I love seeing that because that's what I see is that there's your Disney villain. And so it was that part's cool. But the one of the things I remember when I was watching this, I'd watched the special on Netflix, the Movies That Made Us, and I didn't realize that originally Danny Elfman was Jack.
No, he does the singing for Jack.
But he was going to be the actor for Jack, and then
I didn't remember that.
Yeah, and then no, we're going to keep you singing, and they brought somebody in. Unless I'm remembering this incorrectly, I could have sworn that's exactly
what I thought it was. The actor, hold on, I got IMDb up. I thought it was Christopher Sarandon that they said, "Hey, you're going to sing," and he said, "I can't sing."
You know what? Maybe
that's how I remember it. Yeah. One of us is right, unless we're in that.
One of us is wrong.
What do they call it? The Dalai, not Dalai Lama effect.
The mandala effect.
Mandala effect. Yeah. Which I'm starting to believe more and more as I get older and older.
Yep. That's why I was like, "Do I really remember that?" And that was it. And just rolling back, do I really remember seeing Tim Burton on the title card for this movie?
Because I do.
Yeah, but maybe not. Maybe not. Yeah.
Mandela effect. We're just, ever since they turned on that that turbo thing over in Sweden.
Oh, the CERN collider?
The CERN collider. They fucked up our dimension. That's all there is to it. Well, but that's another.
It's another really podcast. Affecting the 5G from my vaccination. I'm just saying. Anyway, back to the movie.
But I can pick up Calcutta. It's great.
It's fucking great. My reception is awesome. I get a booster. I get another 100 miles, you know? Shit. Next thing you know, I'll be gay and selling Girl Scout cookies.
And you'll look like, who was that? What was that guy's name? He played Dr. Frankenfurter. I always forget his name.
Tim Curry.
And he's in the police squad.
Yeah.
Your Girl Scout cookies. He's got the mustache and everything. Sorry, folks, we're going all over different.
Okay,
movies.
Yeah, back to Nightmare Before Christmas. Nightmare, yeah, Nightmare Before Christmas.
Danny
yeah.
Elfman did the singing voice for Jack Skellington. Christopher Sarandon did Jack Skellington's voice. Catherine O'Hara was Sally, yeah. And she sang for the voice too, if I'm not mistaken. And Shock. And I was really shocked to find that out because I love
Catherine O'Hare.
Yeah, I probably saw it on the credits when it was rolling, but it didn't click. William Hickey was Dr. Finkelstein. Glenn Shaddix was the mayor. Now Glenn Shaddix is the guy that's in Beetlejuice, the soothsayer guy that's in Beetlejuice. He passed away a while back. But I didn't know he was the mayor. That's just amazing to me.
And so Paul was Catherine O'Hare was in Beetlejuice as well.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Paul Rubens was Locke, the voice
was
for Locke.
Was he really?
Yeah. Ken Page did Oogie Boogie, your favorite man.
I love Oogie Boogie.
Edward Ivory was Santa. Susan McBride was the big witch. And I could just keep going. Well, yeah, there's all sorts of names in here.
Oh,
but
yeah, because
there's just so many people in here. Yeah. You just lose.
You hit the main ones.
But those are the main ones. And I'm telling you, for my money, honestly, you don't get any better. And I like watching Corpse Bride every year for Halloween.
Corpse Bride is good. It's really good.
And that's really good. That's a really good version, too. A lot of really good stop motion.
Oh yeah,
this just opened it up. It was like there was no stop motion going on in the world.
No.
And then they did this movie and it just, everybody was like, holy crap, we can do this. The only stop motion that I can think of that was going on was the Aardman Aardman animation stuff. Which, and that was, do you know who that is?
No, that's, who is
that? Chicken Run. They did Chicken Run. They did, Shaun the Sheep.
Okay.
They've done.
So they did a lot of claymation and stuff.
Yeah, a lot of claymation, a lot of good stuff. Oh, Wallace and Gromit. Anything okay. Wallace and Gromit, that's their company.
Okay.
And who I should have said initially, because that's what started their company. And my God, I love that stuff too. But this blew the doors open for animation for quite a while. And I like the fact that they're still going back and touching on it. They're still going back and doing stop motion. And I will always go see a good stop motion movie.
Well, absolutely.
The direction has to be there. The story has to be there, as with any other movie. But for me, the design has to be right too.
Yes.
There's one called Sasquatch or Bigfoot. I think it's on Netflix now. Something like that. Missing Link, maybe. I haven't watched it because I don't like the designs. And I know it's a stupid reason, folks. I know that's a dumb reason not to watch it. But I looked at the designs and I'm like, no, that's just, I don't know why. I couldn't tell you. Well, you know, just something that doesn't click with me.
It's something that I want to talk about that just a second, because we can take a look at Tim Burton's stop motion animation movies,
right?
And you see, or his drawings and stuff. You see
Frankenweenie.
You see his artistic design and his sensibilities, and you see that. You say, that's Tim Burton. You look at Trey and Matt, and you know South Park is some little quick cutouts that it works. It's an artistic choice for that, and I get it when you see something that's like, you know, I really don't like. I run across that with some anime. Some of it's just like, what the hell is this? It just, you know, why are your legs 10 foot long and you have size 2 feet, you know, the little chibi feet and stuff.
I get it.
It's like, I don't, there's certain things, because I'm into a lot of Japanese video games, and there was one I had a really hard time playing because of the character design, because they were done real short, little tiny feet and giant heads. And it just like, this looks so bad. The game is great, but it's like, what is this style? You know?
Was it the...
It was Fire Emblem Awakening on the 3DS. No,
I'm trying to think of the style that they call that.
They call it chibi.
Chibi. Was it the chibi stuff?
Yeah, it's the chibi stuff. That, I don't like... It's the little feet.
Yeah. Little arms coming almost out of the side of
and
their
the big head.
Head
and the,
big,
and yes,
their head's big. It's like...
I don't do the chibi. But after a while, you can get into it. But certain artistic style, you're just drawn to it. And it's like you go to a museum, you see a painting that's like, yes, I like that. Or you see a comic, I like that. There's a reason you're drawn to it. And not everything's going to fire. This is such a cool style. And
such a nice style.
Yeah.
Such good stuff.
And we don't see a lot of stuff like that right now.
Do what? I'm sorry?
We don't see a lot of stuff that has a unique style right now.
No, we don't. And I don't know why. I think they're afraid. I think Hollywood's afraid.
Yeah.
I think they're afraid to make a decision. I think they're afraid to let anybody new in that isn't part of the club, so to speak. And that's sad, because they're, what's the word I'm looking for? They're thinning the blood. They're really.
You don't get a lot of new ideas. You don't get a lot of new stuff. And that's why I love seeing stuff like a movie I watched recently. And I don't know if I talked about it on here. Was Barbarian on HBO.
You talked to me about it a little bit.
Yeah.
And I've heard a lot of good things about it.
All I'm going to say is go into this movie blind. And it's much better. I think if I knew what was going on, I wouldn't have enjoyed it as much. It was full of crazy surprises, but it was unique. James Wan did Malignant like last year, which was a very unique horror movie. So I'm seeing Hollywood start to do this. One of the biggest surprises is Terrifier 2, which is out in the theater now. Low budget indie, just kicking ass. And it's that's awesome.
Both of those movies I've heard about on another channel on YouTube called Film Threat,
right,
with Chris Gore and Alan Ng, and those two guys have a really good program, folks. I'm not trying to get rid of you, but if you like independent movies, they talk a lot about independent horror. They're the ones who brought up
Evil Head, Dead
Evil
by
Head,
Dawn.
Dead by Dawn. Gee, I don't know who could possibly be starring in that, Scott.
It might be me. And
Evil Head, Dead by Dawn.
Look
they
it up,
actually
folks.
Reviewed it over on Film Threat. Not on their show, but in their magazine portion of their show. And yeah. they mentioned it. But they mentioned a lot of like independent stuff and little things. And they mentioned Barbarian. They mentioned the Terrifier.
Terrifier.
And then Terrifier 2.
Yeah.
And I mean, they just go off on all sorts of neat stuff. RRR is a movie I have in my queue on Netflix. I want to watch it. It's an Indian movie, but it's 3 hours. So I have to.
Yeah, you have to prepare.
I have to prepare. And I'm probably going to watch
it. Is it going to have dance
version.
Numbers?
Huh?
Is it going to have some Bollywood dance numbers?
Of course it is.
Absolutely.
I don't know that any Indian movie.
It has to. I don't care what genre.
I found a really neat one. I forgot the name of it. Rama, I think.
That sounds familiar. That sounds really familiar.
That one is on, I believe, Amazon.
Okay.
And it's got a nice design. Speaking of designs, which is why I'm talking about all this stuff. It's all designs. It's all interesting. It's all new ideas. And it's all happening right now in independent film.
Mm-hmm.
You would never be able to make this movie, Nightmare Before Christmas, right now, I don't think. Yeah. If it had never been done, if it wasn't Tim Burton's name being written on anything, if somebody just went to a guy in Hollywood and went, look, I got a stop motion movie. It's going to make you billions of dollars. They would say no.
They're scared to death.
Because they're terrified of a good new idea that one of them didn't come up
with. Well, they are afraid to take a risk. They want everything to be a sure thing. Mm-hmm. And while I get that, it causes the industry to stagnate. Mm-hmm. And you don't get the new stuff. You don't get the independent stuff. That's why I love seeing filmmakers go out and make their own stuff. And look, this is not to get into any social political things or whatever, but just take Mel Gibson, for example.
Mm-hmm.
He could no longer work in Hollywood because he ran his mouth. Mm-hmm. And what did he do? He started his own studio and made some killer fucking movies.
Yeah. Movies that nobody could ignore because they were just so damn good.
But they're also movies that wouldn't have been made. It was a blessing because he got to do stuff that he wanted to do and take a chance. And that's what's missing is seeing stuff like that is the artists and the directors who go out there and just do it against all odds on that. So,
and that's what I want to see more of. Enough with the superhero movies, Hollywood, you're not doing them well. I heard Black Adam. Now, I was looking at The Rock and I was just like, no. He looks the part, but he doesn't have the hair, no pointy ears. I'm not sure because that's a big thing with me. I want the character
the
character to look like the character. But everybody that's seen it that I've heard and all the different viewers that I've heard, all the different reviews, everybody that's actually a comic book fan was like, no, he did it. They did a good story. And people are like, well, he's just The Rock. He's doing The Rock. He's like, not exactly. He's a little bit more of an actor in this one.
Mm.
You know? And I was like, oh, so he's actually trying to kind of grow up a little bit as an actor.
I'm interested now. I've watched a lot of movies with Dwayne Johnson, The Rock, and he does have a range, but a lot of times these movies have hired him because he's The Rock. So they cast The Rock, and unfortunately, but I mean, hell, I don't blame him for playing it. So that's good to hear that he's added some depth to it.
So I'm looking forward to seeing it when it comes out on HBO Max. Because I'm not going to the movies to go see it. There's only one movie I want to see at the movies right now.
What is that?
And that's the Santa Claus movie.
Violent Night.
Violent Night. That's the only movie that I'm actually kind of excited about going seeing. I don't even know if it's out at the movies now or not.
It's going to be soon, I think.
If they stream it, I'll probably just stream it because why? Right. I go to the movies because if I don't have to. But that one looks interesting. But this, again, we'll come back because that's an interesting take on all the Santa Claus movies. This is an interesting take on a Santa Claus Christmas story. But it's one of the few stories about Halloween. I mean, we had the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown. And we had the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown.
Yeah.
I can't think really. I mean, There was like a couple of horror movies here and there. Yeah, for Halloween. I mean, you had the movie Halloween.
No big Halloween special. Like,
yeah, but well, this was
if you want to count The Simpsons for the past 30 years with their treehouse of horror or whatever. Yeah. But that's about it. The only big Halloween thing that would happen.
But this to me is an absolute classic. It was a classic the day it was released. It was just, I remember Kat and I looking at each other and going, we're going to buy this. Like, whatever it comes out on, we're going to buy this because, damn, this is a good movie. I think we might have actually gone back to the movies to see this twice.
Okay, I can see that.
Which is very few movies that I would do that with. This was well written. Voice acting was superb.
You got Danny Elfman with the music, the score, the songs.
Oh, my God. The music score, Oingo Boingo's Danny Elfman. I mean, forget about it.
He's brilliant.
And his wife at the time was, she was either one of the animators or she was one of the writers.
I forget. I remember they were hooked. And they got along. He has a connection, yeah.
Yeah, they had that connection and she would like help him and he would help her. And like that helped him make the music more for the movie, and it worked really well. You're like, holy crap, how could you two get divorced? What is wrong with you? But I understand not everybody stays together, but it was like, holy cow, you just such a good movie all the way across. The character designs, the storytelling, the voiceover. Folks, I don't have a bad thing to say about this. This is gonna be a short episode today, because this movie, if I were rating this, and we don't rate movies, but if I was rating this on a scale of 1 to 10, I'd say it's an 11. Go see it or buy it. I'm waiting for them to re-release it at the theater. I would love to go see this on the big screen again. I'd love it.
Well, I will talk briefly about, I didn't see it on the big screen, but I did recently purchase a 65-inch TV, and it was glorious on this giant screen.
Nice, isn't it?
Oh, it was. You know, I streamed it off Disney, so they have it in 4K Ultra HD, and it is just brilliant, gorgeous movie.
Now, I know that they were doing something a few years ago. They were, for whatever reason, they were digitizing the movie to make it computer animated.
Hmm.
And I remember looking over at the old lady going, why? What is the point of that? Is it just you're trying out a new tech just to see if you can do something?
Maybe they were. I don't know.
That's the only thing I can come up with. As far as I know, it was never released anywhere.
Right, right.
So I don't know what the point of it was.
Hmm.
But, interesting. Oh, my God, those models. I remember when the dolls were coming out, and I could never find the ones that I wanted. I always wanted Sally. I always wanted Jack Skellington, the three Lock, Stock, and Barrel. Lock, Shock, and Barrel, or something like whatever the three little bastards are. You know, those are the ones that I always wanted. I can never find them. But man, good stuff. Now they're starting to come out with the action figures.
That's very
action
cool.
figures. I'm an action figure. Again, every once in a while, you see the dolls. It's not a doll. Yeah. It's an action figure. Okay. All right.
Well, since Dave has given this movie a 20 out of 10, I knew you would love it based on your animation background, of course. And I love watching the artistic creation here. This was a hell of an endeavor, and it works on so many levels, and it just comes together. I find it interesting that we both thought it was a big Tim Burton thing, and I didn't see his name anywhere. It's like, oh, that's interesting. This is not a Tim Burton.
When you find out, you're like, wow, what a ripoff. He's busy making a Batman movie.
Yeah. Which a lot of these styles are in.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is great.
You know, a Tim Burton movie.
Oh, God, yes. God, yes. But I definitely recommend giving this movie a watch. Great acting, songs, soundtrack. And it's a love story.
Yeah.
It really is. And Sally tries so hard. Jack is just so... Jack is Jack. You know, Jack just
focused in.
He wants something different.
He's so focused. He's got his blinders on.
He's definitely got blinders.
A little rag doll trying to hit on him, and he's just like focused, like, no, I got, I'm going to steal Christmas.
My favorite part of the movie is her rescue of him. She's got no hands. Her leg is over here. Their body parts are doing things. It's great. It's great. But yes, I definitely give it a watch. Check it out.
Definitely.
And make sure if you like what you hear and see, hit subscribe, hit like, hit share. Appreciate all the new people that have been joining us. Thank you very much. And we are in the Christmas season now as we transitioned from Halloween movies into Christmas time. So don't know what's coming, but stay tuned.
Oh, and folks, don't forget, Rumble is a thing. We are in the middle of transferring all of our videos here on YouTube over to Rumble. We are getting some business over there.
There we go.
Not a lot of followers, but we're getting views and a lot of likes over there.
Yeah, so if you want to see our channel elsewhere, drop us a line, let us know, and we will try and make it happen.
Yeah, sure. If there's any other place like a Rumble or a YouTube, let us know, and we'll get it over there somehow. I don't know how. We'll figure it out.
Some way.
Not the most tech-savvy guy in the world.
All right, folks. Thanks for joining in, and we will catch you next week.
Thank you very much, y'all. Have a good one.